بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله الذي أنزل على عبده الكتاب ولم يجعل له عوجا قيما لينذر بأسا شديدا من لدنه ويبشر المؤمنين الذين يعملون الصالحات أن لهم أجرا حسنا ماكثين فيه أبدا وينذر الذين قالوا اتخذ الله ولدا ما لهم به من علم ولا لآبائهم كبرت كلمة تخرج من أفواههم إن يقولون إلا كذبا فلعلك باخع نفسك على آثارهم إن لم يؤمنوا بهذا الحديث أسفا إنا جعلنا ما على الأرض زينة لها لنبلوهم أيهم أحسن عملا وإنا لجاعلون ما عليها صعيدا جرزا أم حسبت أن أصحاب الكهف والرقيم كانوا من آياتنا عجبا إذ أوى الفتية إلى الكهف فقالوا ربنا آتنا من لدنك رحمة وهيئ لنا من أمرنا رشدا فضربنا على آذانهم في الكهف سنين عددا ثم بعثناهم لنعلم أي الحزبين أحصى لما لبثوا أمدا نحن نقص عليك نبأهم بالحق إنهم فتية آمنوا بربهم وزدناهم هدى وربطنا على قلوبهم إذ قاموا فقالوا ربنا رب السماوات والأرض لن ندعو من دونه إلها لقد قلنا إذا شططا هؤلاء قومنا اتخذوا من دونه آلهة لولا يأتون عليهم بسلطان بين فمن أظلم ممن افترى على الله كذبا وإذ اعتزلتموهم وما يعبدون إلا الله فأووا إلى الكهف ينشر لكم ربكم من رحمته ويهيئ لكم من أمركم مرفقا وترى الشمس إذا طلعت تزاور عن كهفهم ذات اليمين وإذا غربت تقرضهم ذات الشمال وهم في فجوة منه ذلك من آيات الله من يهد الله فهو المهتدي ومن يضلل فلن تجد له وليا مرشدا وتحسبهم أيقاظا وهم رقود ونقلبهم ذات اليمين وذات الشمال وكلبهم باسط ذراعيه بالوصيد لو اطلعت عليهم لوليت منهم فرارا ولملئت منهم رعبا وكذلك بعثناهم ليتساءلوا بينهم قال قائل منهم كم لبثتم قالوا لبثنا يوما أو بعض يوم قالوا ربكم أعلم بما لبثتم فبعثوا أحدكم بورقكم هذه إلى المدينة فلينظر أيها أزكى طعاما فليأتكم برزق منه وليتلطف ولا يشعرن بكم أحدا إنهم إن يظهروا عليكم يرجموكم أو يعيدوكم في ملتهم ولن تفلحوا إذا أبدا وكذلك أعثرنا عليهم ليعلموا أن وعد الله حق وأن الساعة لا ريب فيها إذ يتنازعون بينهم أمرهم فقالوا بنوا عليهم بنيانا ربهم أعلم بهم قال الذين غلبوا على أمرهم لنتخذن عليهم مسجدا سيقولون ثلاثة رابعهم كلبهم ويقولون خمسة سادسهم كلبهم رجما بالغيب ويقولون سبعة وثامنهم كلبهم قل ربي أعلم بعدتهم ما يعلمهم إلا قليل فلا تمار فيهم إلا مراء ظاهرا ولا تستفت فيهم منهم أحدا ولا تقولن لشيء إني فاعل ذلك غدا إلا أن يشاء الله واذكر ربك إذا نسيت وقل عسى أن يهديني ربي لأقرب من هذا رشدا ولبثوا في كهفهم 300 سنين وازدادوا 9 قل الله أعلم بما لبثوا له غيب السماوات والأرض أبصر به وأسمع ما لهم من دونه من ولي ولا يشرك في حكمه أحدا واتل ما أوحي إليك من كتاب ربك لا مبدل لكلماته ولن تجد من دونه ملتحدا واصبر نفسك مع الذين يدعون ربهم بالغداة والعشي يريدون وجهه ولا تعد عيناك عنهم تريد زينة الحياة الدنيا ولا تطع من أغفلنا قلبه عن ذكرنا واتبع هواه وكان أمره فرطا وقل الحق من ربكم فمن شاء فليؤمن ومن شاء فليكفر إنا أعتدنا للظالمين نارا أحاط بهم سرادقها وإن يستغيثوا يغاثوا بماء كالمهل يشوي الوجوه بئس الشراب وساءت مرتفقا إن الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات إنا لا نضيع أجر من أحسن عملا أولئك لهم جنات عدن تجري من تحتهم الأنهار يحلون فيها من أساور من ذهب ويلبسون ثيابا خضرا من سندس وإستبرق متكئين فيها على الأرائك نعم الثواب وحسنت مرتفقا واضرب لهم مثلا الرجلين جعلنا لأحدهما جنتين من أعناب وحففناهما بنخل وجعلنا بينهما زرعا كلتا الجنتين آتت أكلها ولم تظلم منه شيئا وفجرنا خلالهما نهرا وكان له ثمر فقال لصاحبه وهو يحاوره أنا أكثر منك مالا وأعز نفرا ودخل جنته وهو ظالم لنفسه قال ما أظن أن تبيد هذه أبدا وما أظن الساعة قائمة ولئن رددت إلى ربي لأجدن خيرا منها منقلبا قال له صاحبه وهو يحاوره أكفرت بالذي خلقك من تراب ثم من نطفة ثم سواك رجلا لكن هو الله ربي ولا أشرك بربي أحدا ولولا إذ دخلت جنتك قلت ما شاء الله لا قوة إلا بالله إن ترني أنا أقل منك مالا وولدا فعسى ربي أن يؤتيني خيرا من جنتك ويرسل عليها حسبانا من السماء فتصبح صعيدا زلقا أو يصبح ماؤها غورا فلن تستطيع له طلبا وأحيط بثمره فأصبح يقلب كفيه على ما أنفق فيها وهي خاوية على عروشها ويقول يا ليتني لم أشرك بربي أحدا ولم تكن له فئة ينصرونه من دون الله وما كان منتصرا هنالك الولاية لله الحق هو خير ثوابا وخير عقبا واضرب لهم مثل الحياة الدنيا كماء أنزلناه من السماء فاختلط به نبات الأرض فأصبح هشيما تذروه الرياح وكان الله على كل شيء مقتدرا المال والبنون زينة الحياة الدنيا والباقيات الصالحات خير عند ربك ثوابا وخير أملا ويوم نسير الجبال وترى الأرض بارزة وحشرناهم فلم نغادر منهم أحدا وعرضوا على ربك صفا لقد جئتمونا كما خلقناكم أول مرة بل زعمتم أن لن نجعل لكم موعدا ووضع الكتاب فترى المجرمين مشفقين مما فيه ويقولون يا ويلتنا ما لهذا الكتاب لا يغادر صغيرة ولا كبيرة إلا أحصاها ووجدوا ما عملوا حاضرا ولا يظلم ربك أحدا وإذ قلنا للملائكة اسجدوا لآدم فسجدوا إلا إبليس كان من الجن ففسق عن أمر ربه أفتتخذونه وذريته أولياء من دوني وهم لكم عدو بئس للظالمين بدلا ما أشهدتهم خلق السماوات والأرض ولا خلق أنفسهم وما كنت متخذ المضلين عضدا ويوم يقول نادوا شركائي الذين زعمتم فدعوهم فلم يستجيبوا لهم وجعلنا بينهم موبقا ورأى المجرمون النار فظنوا أنهم مواقعها ولم يجدوا عنها مصرفا ولقد صرفنا في هذا القرآن للناس من كل مثل وكان الإنسان أكثر شيء جدلا وما منع الناس أن يؤمنوا إذ جاءهم الهدى ويستغفروا ربهم إلا أن تأتيهم سنة الأولين أو يأتيهم العذاب قبلا وما نرسل المرسلين إلا مبشرين ومنذرين ويجادل الذين كفروا بالباطل ليدحضوا به الحق واتخذوا آياتي وما أنذروا هزوا ومن أظلم ممن ذكر بآيات ربه فأعرض عنها ونسي ما قدمت يداه إنا جعلنا على قلوبهم أكنة أن يفقهوه وفي آذانهم وقرا وإن تدعهم إلى الهدى فلن يهتدوا إذا أبدا وربك الغفور ذو الرحمة لو يؤاخذهم بما كسبوا لعجل لهم العذاب بل لهم موعد لن يجدوا من دونه موئلا وتلك القرى أهلكناهم لما ظلموا وجعلنا لمهلكهم موعدا وإذ قال موسى لفتاه لا أبرح حتى أبلغ مجمع البحرين أو أمضي حقبا فلما بلغا مجمع بينهما نسيا حوتهما فاتخذ سبيله في البحر سربا فلما جاوزا قال لفتاه آتنا غداءنا لقد لقينا من سفرنا هذا نصبا قال أرأيت إذ أوينا إلى الصخرة فإني نسيت الحوت وما أنسانيه إلا الشيطان أن أذكره واتخذ سبيله في البحر عجبا قال ذلك ما كنا نبغي فارتدا على آثارهما قصصا فوجدا عبدا من عبادنا آتيناه رحمة من عندنا وعلمناه من لدنا علما قال له موسى هل أتبعك على أن تعلمني مما علمت رشدا قال إنك لن تستطيع معي صبرا وكيف تصبر على ما لم تحط به خبرا قال ستجدني إن شاء الله صابرا ولا أعصي لك أمرا قال فإن اتبعتني فلا تسألني عن شيء حتى أحدث لك منه ذكرا فانطلقا حتى إذا ركبا في السفينة خرقها قال أخرقتها لتغرق أهلها لقد جئت شيئا إمرا قال ألم أقل إنك لن تستطيع معي صبرا قال لا تؤاخذني بما نسيت ولا ترهقني من أمري عسرا فانطلقا حتى إذا لقيا غلاما فقتله قال أقتلت نفسا زكية بغير نفس لقد جئت شيئا نكرا قال ألم أقل لك إنك لن تستطيع معي صبرا قال إن سألتك عن شيء بعدها فلا تصاحبني قد بلغت من لدني عذرا فانطلقا حتى إذا أتيا أهل قرية استطعما أهلها فأبوا أن يضيفوهما فوجدا فيها جدارا يريد أن ينقض فأقامه قال لو شئت لاتخذت عليه أجرا قال هذا فراق بيني وبينك سأنبئك بتأويل ما لم تستطع عليه صبرا أما السفينة فكانت لمساكين يعملون في البحر فأردت أن أعيبها وكان وراءهم ملك يأخذ كل سفينة غصبا وأما الغلام فكان أبواه مؤمنين فخشينا أن يرهقهما طغيانا وكفرا فأردنا أن يبدلهما ربهما خيرا منه زكاة وأقرب رحما وأما الجدار فكان لغلامين يتيمين في المدينة وكان تحته كنز لهما وكان أبوهما صالحا فأراد ربك أن يبلغا أشدهما ويستخرجا كنزهما رحمة من ربك وما فعلته عن أمري ذلك تأويل ما لم تسطع عليه صبرا ويسألونك عن ذي القرنين قل سأتلو عليكم منه ذكرا إنا مكنا له في الأرض وآتيناه من كل شيء سببا فأتبع سببا حتى إذا بلغ مغرب الشمس وجدها تغرب في عين حمئة ووجد عندها قوما قلنا يا ذا القرنين إما أن تعذب وإما أن تتخذ فيهم حسنا قال أما من ظلم فسوف نعذبه ثم يرد إلى ربه فيعذبه عذابا نكرا وأما من آمن وعمل صالحا فله جزاء الحسنى وسنقول له من أمرنا يسرا ثم أتبع سببا حتى إذا بلغ مطلع الشمس وجدها تطلع على قوم لم نجعل لهم من دونها سترا كذلك وقد أحطنا بما لديه خبرا ثم أتبع سببا حتى إذا بلغ بين السدين وجد من دونهما قوما لا يكادون يفقهون قولا قالوا يا ذا القرنين إن يأجوج ومأجوج مفسدون في الأرض فهل نجعل لك خرجا على أن تجعل بيننا وبينهم سدا قال ما مكنني فيه ربي خير فأعينوني بقوة أجعل بينكم وبينهم ردما آتوني زبر الحديد حتى إذا ساوى بين الصدفين قال انفخوا حتى إذا جعله نارا قال آتوني أفرغ عليه قطرا فما استطاعوا أن يظهروه وما استطاعوا له نقبا قال هذا رحمة من ربي فإذا جاء وعد ربي جعله دكاء وكان وعد ربي حقا وتركنا بعضهم يومئذ يموج في بعض ونفخ في الصور فجمعناهم جمعا وعرضنا جهنم يومئذ للكافرين عرضا الذين كانت أعينهم في غطاء عن ذكري وكانوا لا يستطيعون سمعا أفحسب الذين كفروا أن يتخذوا عبادي من دوني أولياء إنا أعتدنا جهنم للكافرين نزلا قل هل ننبئكم بالأخسرين أعمالا الذين ضل سعيهم في الحياة الدنيا وهم يحسبون أنهم يحسنون صنعا أولئك الذين كفروا بآيات ربهم ولقائه فحبطت أعمالهم فلا نقيم لهم يوم القيامة وزنا ذلك جزاؤهم جهنم بما كفروا واتخذوا آياتي ورسلي هزوا إن الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات كانت لهم جنات الفردوس نزلا خالدين فيها لا يبغون عنها حولا قل لو كان البحر مدادا لكلمات ربي لنفد البحر قبل أن تنفد كلمات ربي ولو جئنا بمثله مددا قل إنما أنا بشر مثلكم يوحى إلي أنما إلهكم إله واحد فمن كان يرجو لقاء ربه فليعمل عملا صالحا ولا يشرك بعبادة ربه أحدا صدق الله العظيم.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على سيدنا ونبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين والتابعين لهم بإحسان ودعا بدعوتهم واستنى بسنتهم إلى يوم الدين أما بعد فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم ما يفعل الله بعذابكم إن شكرتم وآمنتم وكان الله شاكرا عليما وقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم من أصبح منكم آمنا في سربه معافا في جسده عنده قوت يومه فكأنما حيزت له الدنيا بحذافيرها وقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم انظروا إلى من هو أسفل منكم ولا تنظروا إلى من هو فوقكم فإنه أجدر ألا تزدروا نعمة الله أو كما قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. Respected listeners, brothers and sisters, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam changed our perspective on many different fronts where our thinking, our outlook, our perspective was wrong. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam directed us to the correct way of thinking, to the correct way of looking at things, to better us in this life and in the hereafter. And one of the greatest aspects which Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam focused upon and which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself directs us towards is being grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for his favors. What we call shukr, being grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for his favors. And in whatever situation a person finds themselves in, whatever circumstances a person sees themselves in, whatever a person is going through, is experiencing, whatever ups and downs we have in life, that we always look and focus at the positive things. And we never lose sight of the favors of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we never lose sight of the ni'mat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this, unfortunately, shukr is one of the areas that we are greatly lacking in. Where something small goes wrong in our life. Everything up to a particular point was going perfectly well. It was smooth sailing, no issues, no problems. But one small thing goes wrong and we feel like the whole world has upturned. We feel that we've got nothing, and then we begin to lose sight of the many, many favors and ni'mats of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that Allah is still showering us with. Because of that one difficulty or that one mishap or that one hardship that we're experiencing. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam taught us not to think like this. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam taught us to count and to think and to appreciate every ni'mat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, "Man asbaha minkum aminan fi sirbihi." That whoever amongst you wakes up in the morning, aminan fi sirbihi, and he is perfectly secure and safe amongst his family. So you wake up in the morning and you have a roof over your head. You're well, your family is well. You have no fear whatsoever. You can leave your home without fear. You can walk the streets without fear. Alhamdulillah, we've all made our way to the masjid. How many of us even thought for a moment that when I leave my house, it may not be safe to get to the masjid? I may encounter some danger, I may encounter some enemy, I may encounter some threat in coming to the masjid. I don't think anyone here had that fear when they left their homes. This is a safety that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has granted it. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, "Whosoever amongst you wakes up in the morning and he is safe and sound amongst his family. Mu'afan fi jasadihi." And Allah has granted him afiyah, well-being, good health in his body. So, alhamdulillah, we've been able to make our way here to the masjid. Alhamdulillah, you know, besides the small ups and downs and the slight illnesses that we all have and we all experience from time to time, but alhamdulillah, we are sat here in the masjid. We are sat in the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I am speaking through the afiyah that Allah has granted me. You are listening and you are understanding and it's registering in your mind, it's processing in your mind because of the afiyah that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has granted you. Mu'afan fi jasadihi, Allah has granted him well-being and health in his body. Indahu qutu yawmihi, and he has enough food for that day. Now Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is not talking about how much we stocked up and piled up for the whole week or for the whole month or till the end of the year. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, "Indahu qutu yawmihi," that he has enough food for that day. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam then tells us that what and how we should consider ourselves. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, "Faka'annama hizat lahu dunya bihadafiriha." It is as though the whole world has been gathered for you and given to you on a plate. You've got the whole world. This is your kingdom that Allah has given you. Once a Sahabi, Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As radiallahu anhumah, another Sahabi from amongst the Muhajireen, the poor Muhajireen, he said that, "Are we not from the poor Muhajireen?" So Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As radiallahu anhumah said to him, that, do you have a wife? He said, "Yes, I have a wife." He said, "Do you have a house, a roof over your head?" He said, "Yes, I have a roof over my head." So he said, "You are from the rich people then. Don't consider yourself poor. Anta min al-aghniya." You are from the rich. This individual then added further, he said, "I also have a khadim, a servant who looks after our needs." So he said, "Anta min al-muluk," then you're a king. If you've got all of this, you're a king. This is your kingdom that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given you. So appreciating the ni'mats of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, extremely, extremely important. And when a person loses sight of the ni'mat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when a person does not appreciate the favors of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then deprives a person. The reason why Allah has given us everything, as Sayyidina Sulaiman radiallahu anhu said, "Hada min fadli Rabbi." This is from the grace of my Rabb. "Liyabluwani ashkuru am akfur." So that he can test me to see, am I grateful or am I ungrateful? Allah says very clearly with respect to gratitude, "La'in shakartum la'azidannakum." If you are grateful, then I shall increase you. I shall increase you in my favors. "Wala'in kafartum inna adhabi la shadeed." And if you are ungrateful, then my punishment is severe. Now when we talk about the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with respect to the favors of Allah, we think that punishment means that we're going to lose everything. So a person will wake up in the morning and his bank account has been cleared and he's got no roof over his head, he's lost his family, he's lost everything. This is not necessarily the meaning of Allah's punishment. Sayyidina Hassan al-Basri rahmatullah alayhi says that when Allah gives a person a ni'mah, Allah expects shukr upon that ni'mah. Allah wants you to be grateful for that ni'mah. Allah wants you to express gratitude for that ni'mah. And he says that if you don't express gratitude upon that ni'mah, what will Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala do? Allah will turn this very ni'mah and favor of Allah into a punishment. Allah will turn it into a punishment. And this is what we see. People have absolutely every luxury imaginable. People have. They've got beautiful houses, they've got comfortable beds, they've got so much money at their disposal, they've got family, they've got children, they've got extended family, they have all these things. But when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not shown gratitude for these ni'mats and for these favors, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala turns each and every one of these ni'mats against this individual. They become a means of this person going through so much difficulty, so much headache, so much pain. So these very favors of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then turn against this individual and they become the means of this person going through difficulty. And you have others, they live a very simple life. Very simple life. What we would consider to be poverty or below the poverty line. But because they are grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for what they've been given by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they are grateful, they are thankful, and they're enjoying themselves. They live a life of comfort. Despite the difficulty, they're living a life of comfort because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grants them contentment of the heart. And when contentment of the heart is taken away, when a person is not grateful for the favors of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah removes contentment of the heart, and this becomes the first means of a person being punished. That a person has everything, but a person feels that I've got nothing. So he can be a multi-millionaire. He can have everything at his disposal. But this person feels that I still don't have enough. And this person feels always feeling agitated, always feeling anxious, always wanting more, more, more. And until his urge and his greed for more is not satisfied, this person feels he's got nothing. So despite having everything, he feels he's got nothing. This in itself is a punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And when a person has little, but a person understands that this is everything, Allah's given me so much, and a person reflects over this hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that you've woken up with peace and security amongst your family, and alhamdulillah, Allah has granted you health and well-being in your body, and you have enough food for the day, then Allah has given you everything, Allah has given you the whole world. When a person thinks like this, then a person is going to be content. And the other hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that I read to you, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave us another prescription and formula. تَأُنْظُرُوا إِلَى مَنْ هُوَ أَسْفَلَ مِنْكُمْ. That always look towards those who are below you. Look towards those who are below you. Look towards those who are less fortunate. So if you're living in a three-bedroom house, look at those people who don't even have a house over their head. If you're driving a car, then look at those people who don't drive. If Allah's given you feet, look at those people who don't even have feet, who can't even walk, who are disabled. So in every situation, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us to look at those who are below us. And when we look at those who are below us, then we will appreciate whatever we have. وَلَا تَنْظُرُوا إِلَى مَنْ هُوَ فَوْقَكُمْ. And do not look towards those who are above you. Do not look towards those who have been given more. Because when you're going to look towards those who have been given more, then you're always going to be ungrateful for what you have. What you've been given, you're not going to appreciate it. You're going to consider it to be less. You're going to consider it to be not adequate for your needs. And you're always going to be in this constant anguish and heartache that I need more, I need more, I need more. I need to be like this individual. I need to compete with this person. That's why Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was told, وَلَا تَمُدَّنَّ عَيْنَيْكَ إِلَى مَا مَتَّعْنَا بِهِ أَزْوَاجًا مِنْهُمْ زَهْرَةَ الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا لِنَفْتِنَهُمْ فِيهِ. That don't even look towards the lushness and the beauty and the glamour that we've given so many of these people. Why are we giving them? لِنَفْتِنَهُمْ فِيهِ, to test them. We think that test just means a person's going through difficulty, a person's going through illness, a person's going through financial difficulties. This is the only test that we consider. But being given wealth, this is also a test from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Being given health is also a test from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Being given ni'mat, this is also a test from Allah. And what is our test? Are we grateful to Allah for Allah's favors, or are we ungrateful? And this is perhaps a greater test. Because when a person is going through difficulty and hardship, this person realizes that they've been tested. But when a person is enjoying so many luxuries and so many comforts, and a person has everything, then this person forgets Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This person forgets that he's enjoying so many of the favors and ni'mats of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So it's extremely important that we turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And at all times, we always look at the positives. We always look at the positives. The positives always outweigh the negatives. There was one student, he went to meet his teacher who was ill. And he asked him, Sheikh, how are you feeling? So the Sheikh said, Alhamdulillah, my eyes are working perfectly fine. Alhamdulillah, I can hear perfectly well. Alhamdulillah, I can speak, I can talk. Alhamdulillah, I can understand what you're saying. Alhamdulillah, my hands are working perfectly fine. And in this manner, he went from head to toe, and he mentioned all of his bodily limbs and parts that are functioning perfectly well. And right at the end, he said, however, I'm feeling slightly ill in this regard. So he's reminding himself, and he's also reminding his student, that don't just look at the illness and forget everything else that you've been given. Think of all of the ni'mats of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from head to toe that you've been granted. So gratitude to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is extremely important. And how do we express gratitude to Allah? One is just with the tongue. This is the first stage of shukr. That with the tongue we express gratitude to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and we never complain. Never complain. Whatever condition you are in, say Alhamdulillah ala kulli hal. All praise is due to Allah in whatever condition I'm in. Be thankful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Be grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Think over Allah's ni'mat and Allah's favors over you. And this will then induce gratitude within you. And the second stage of shukr is that every ni'mat that Allah has given us, we utilize it in those things which please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in the things which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has commanded. So Allah has given us feet. The shukr of these feet is that we walk with these feet to the masjid. Allah has given us eyes. The shukr of these eyes is that we look at those things which please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We read the Quran, we go to for Umrah and Hajj, and we look at the Kaaba. So every limb has its shukr. And we don't use these ni'mats of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah grants us these favors. Allah has granted us these ni'mats. Allah has given us all these things. And then we use these to disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We use these against the being who's granted them to us. This is the height of ingratitude. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the tawfiq to always be grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for His favors, to always be mindful of His favors. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us from ingratitude. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam taught a dua that we should all read after every salah. He said to his companion Sayyidina Mu'adh, Ya Mu'adh, inni uhibbuk. O Mu'adh, I love you. So after every salah, do not forget to say, Allahumma a'inni ala dhikrika wa shukrika wa husni ibadati. O Allah, help me to remember you, to be grateful to you, and to worship you well. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us all tawfiq. Wa akhiru da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in.
Allahu akbar, Allahu akbar. Allahu akbar, Allahu akbar. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن محمد رسول الله أشهد أن محمد رسول الله حي على الصلاة حي على الصلاة حي على الفلاح حي على الله أكبر الله أكبر لا إله إلا الله
Thank you.
Just one important announcement regarding a program that will be taking place tomorrow here at the Masjid after Isha Salah. Inshallah, there will be a program on the life and the virtues of Sayyidina Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu, and the talks will be delivered by a very famous world-renowned speaker, Sheikh Ahmed Ali from Bradford, and also Sheikh Muhammad Ahmed from Bolton. And this program is being carried out in conjunction with Ummah Welfare Trust. So the program will be tomorrow on the virtues and the life of Sayyidina Ali radiallahu anhu after Isha Salah. Isha Salah is at 6:30 p.m. tomorrow, and this program is open for brothers and sisters, and food will also be served after the program. So please try to attend. Jazakumullah khair.
Assalamu alaikum. Brothers are requested to move forward. Stand up and just move forward and fill any gaps which are in front of you. Tamam bhaiyon se guzarish hai ki zara khade ho jaye aur agar aage jagah ho to usko pur kar le. And a request that please wear your mask throughout the time you are in the masjid.
الحمد لله حمد الشاكرين والصلاة والسلام الأكملان الأتمان على سيدنا ونبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. أما بعد، فاتقوا الله عباد الله واشكروه على نعمه وآلائه التي لا تعد ولا تحصى قولا وفعلا. فالشكر قولا بالثناء عليه لإنعامه واعتراف منه وفضله، والشكر فعلا بأن تجعلوا نعمته في طاعته ولا تصرفوها في مخالفة أوامره. واعلموا أن الله يرضى عن الشاكرين. قال تعالى: إن تكفروا فإن الله غني عنكم ولا يرضى لعباده الكفر. وَإِنْ تَشْكُرُوا يَرْضَهُ لَكُمْ وَأَثْنَى عَلَى الشَّاكِرِينَ فَقَالَ تَعَالَى عَنْ نُوحٍ عَلَيْهِ السَّلَامُ ذُرِّيَّةَ مَنْ حَمَلْنَا مَعَ نُوحٍ إِنَّهُ كَانَ عَبْدًا شَكُورًا وَقَالَ عَنْ إِبْرَاهِيمَ عَلَيْهِ السَّلَامُ شَاكِرًا لِأَنْعُمِهِ وَأَمَرَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى رَسُولَهُ بِالشُّكْرِ فَقَالَ بَلِ اللَّهَ فَاعْبُدْ وَكُنْ مِنَ الشَّاكِرِينَ وَكَذَلِكَ أَمَرَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ فَقَالَ وَاشْكُرُوا نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ إِنْ كُنْتُمْ إِيَّاهُ تَعْبُدُونَ وقال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم انظروا إلى من هو أسفل منكم ولا تنظروا إلى من هو فوقكم فإنه أجدر أن لا تزدروا نعمة الله وقال لمعاذ رضي الله عنه يا معاذ إني أحبك فلا تدع أن تقول في دبر كل صلاة اللهم أعني على ذكرك وشكرك وحسن عبادتك أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم ما يفعل الله بعذابكم إن شكرتم وآمنتم وكان الله شاكرا عليما بارك الله لي ولكم في القرآن العظيم ونفعني وإياكم بالآيات والذكر الحكيم أستغفر الله لي ولكم ولسائر المسلمين فاستغفروه إنه هو الغفور الرحيم. الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا وسيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمدا عبده ورسوله أما بعد فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد اللهم بارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد اللهم صل على محمد عبدك ورسولك وصل على المؤمنين والمؤمنات والمسلمين والمسلمات وارض اللهم عن الخلفاء الراشدين المهديين أبي بكر وعمر وعثمان وعلي وعن آله الطيبين الطاهرين وعن الصحابة أجمعين وعنا معهم بمنك وكرمك يا أكرم الأكرمين اللهم عز الإسلام والمسلمين اللهم انصر الإسلام والمسلمين اللهم احفظ الحرمين الشريفين والمسجد الأقصى وسائر بلاد المسلمين اللهم أعيد المسجد الأقصى إلى رحاب المسلمين اللهم انصر إخواننا المستضعفين المظلومين في كل مكان يا رب العالمين اللهم عجل بنصرهم اللهم عليك بأعدائهم وأرنا فيهم عجائب قدرتك يا قوي يا عزيز يا رب العالمين اللهم آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار عباد الله رحمكم الله إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون اذكروا الله تعالى يذكركم واشكروه على نعمه يزدكم وادعوه يستجب لكم ولذكر الله أكبر الله يعلم ما تصنعون. Please straighten your rows, stand shoulder to shoulder, fill in the gaps, and please make sure mobile phones have been switched off.
Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah. قد قامت الصلاة قد قامت الصلاة الله أكبر الله أكبر لا إله إلا الله
الله أكبر الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين سبح اسم ربك الأعلى الذي خلق فسوى والذي قدر فهدى والذي أخرج المرعى فاجعله غثاء أحوى سنقرئك فلا تنسى إلا ما شاء الله إِنَّهُ يَعْلَمُ الْجَهْرَ وَمَا يَخْفَى وَنُيَسِّرُكَ لِلْيُسْرَى فَذَكِّرْ إِنْ نَفَعَتِ الذِّكْرَى سَيَذَّكَّرُ مَنْ يَخْشَى وَيَتَجَنَّبُهَا الْأَشْقَى الَّذِي يَصْلَى النَّارَ الْكُبْرَى ثُمَّ لَا يَمُوتُ فِيهَا وَلَا يَحْيَى قَدْ أَفْلَحَ مَنْ تَزَكَّى وَذَكَرَ اسْمَ رَبِّهِ فَصَلَّى بل تؤثرون الحياة الدنيا والآخرة خير وأبقى إن هذا لفي الصحف الأولى صحف إبراهيم وموسى. الله سميع الله لمن حمده الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين هل أتاك حديث الغاشية وجوه يومئذ خاشعة عاملة ناصبة تصلى نارا حامية تسقى من عين آنية ليس لهم طعام إلا من ضريع لا يسمن ولا يغني من جوع وجوه يومئذ ناعمة لسعيها راضية في جنة عالية لا تسمع فيها لاغية فيها عين جارية فيها سرر مرفوعة وأكواب موضوعة ونمارق مصفوفة وزرابي مبثوثة أفلا ينظرون إلى الإبل كيف خلقت وإلى السماء كيف رفعت وإلى الجبال كيف نصبت وإلى الأرض كيف سطحت فذكر إنما أنت مذكر لست عليهم بمسيطر إلا من تولى وكفر فيعذبه الله العذاب الأكبر إن إلينا إيابهم ثم إن علينا حسابهم الله أكبر سمع الله لمن حمده الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر السلام عليكم ورحمة الله السلام عليكم ورحمة الله استغفر الله استغفر الله استغفر الله تسلم
So two requests for duas is a sister Latifa Abdul Mannan Khalfi who is quite ill in hospital and also sister Hamida Sange from Tanzania she's also in hospital May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant them and all those who are sick, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant them complete shifa and a quick recovery. Subhanallah.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله الحمد لله وكفى وسلام على عباده الذين اصطفى أما بعد فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما رسالة الشريف اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد اللهم بارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد. The word hasad is well known, well understood, and we translate it as jealousy. Yeah, we're all familiar with this term. We know what it means. And the talk's not about hasad, by the way. So just to give us an understanding of what we are going to speak about. So one word we have in Arabic, and we use it in our other kind of languages as well, hasad, and we translate it as jealousy. What does it actually mean? So hasad, in very simple terms, mean that you hate the fact that somebody else has been blessed. You hate the fact that somebody else has been blessed with, it could be anything, it could be a position, it could be an item, it could be a feature, it could be absolutely anything, right? So you hate that somebody's been blessed with something, and you love, so there's two things. One is the element of hate, so you hate that someone's got something or been blessed with something, and the other element of it is that you love for that thing or whatever it is to be taken away from that person. This is hasad. May Allah save us. It's something that everybody goes through every day. Nobody can say that I don't have any hasad at all. You'd be lying. It's a human thing. It's a human being thing that everybody experiences. We're supposed to work towards controlling it. And like I said, the talk's not about that, so I'm not going to go more deeper into it. That's a separate issue in itself. So hasad, jealousy, is to hate for someone to be blessed in a certain way and to love for that blessing to be taken away from them. Whether you get it or not, that's irrelevant. It doesn't necessarily mean that you want that thing. So to hate somebody being blessed and to love for it to be taken away. Now, in the Arabic language, there's another word that's used as well. And that is ghibta. Ghibta. Ghain, ba, ta, and then the round ta, marbuta that we call it. Ghibta. And ghibta in English, we normally translate it as envy. Okay. But they can both get a little bit confused as well, jealousy, envy. And then the reason I'm going to this explanation is so that we understand when we apply it to those who we apply it, so you understand the context and you don't get the wrong meaning of it. So ghibta means, it's quite different to jealousy. You love that somebody's blessed with something, so you love the idea that they've got it. You just marvel at it, wow. You don't hate it. There's no element of why has he got that? Why has she got that? No, you love the idea that somebody's got something, somebody's blessed. And you love to have it as well. And that's permissible, that's allowed. So that's what we call ghibta. You love that somebody's got something and you love that for yourself to be blessed to have the same as well. Now, the reason I went into this introduction is because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has told us two types of people: the prophets, who are the best, and the martyrs, who are the second best. The hadith tells us that the prophets and martyrs, they have ghibta over a certain category of people. The prophets and the martyrs, they have ghibta over a certain category of people. Now, if I say that the prophets are envious of a certain category of people, it might not sound too right. Do you understand why we went through the introduction in the beginning? So ghibta means that you love that somebody's got something and you love to have it for yourself. Okay, so let's use the word ghibta. Now the people who come afterwards, they won't understand what we're talking about. So for you guys, at least you know, you've had this intro, that ghibta and what it means. So when I say ghibta, it means that somebody's been blessed with something and you love the idea of it and you'd love to have it for yourself. This is what we call ghibta. There is a certain category of people that the prophets and the martyrs, they have ghibta over them. They express ghibta. Who are they? Let's look at the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Sayyidina Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu is the one that's narrating this hadith. And he said that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Inna min ibadillah. Inna min ibadillahi. Indeed, from the servants of Allah, there are some servants. Ibad. These are servants of Allah. Who are they? So let's first rule out who they are not. Laysu min al-anbiya. And one hadith is, Wala hum min al-anbiya, wala min al-shuhada. So this category of people that we're speaking about, they are not prophets. And they are not martyrs. Now what's the need to negate these two things? I'll tell you now before we get to the end. It's because what I'm going to tell you about this category of people is so amazing that you hear these kind of things about prophets and martyrs normally. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has already told you as a disclaimer that, by the way, this category of people that we're going to speak about, they are not prophets and they are not martyrs. However, يَغْبِطُهُمُ الْأَنْبِيَاءُ وَالشُّهَدَى. They're not prophets, they're not martyrs, but the prophets and the martyrs have ghibta over these people. In English they say they are envious of them, but it doesn't sound so right. Ghibta is the right meaning here. We're going to use ghibta. So even the prophets and the martyrs have ghibta over these people. So the Sahaba, like, do you guys want to know what category of people these are? You're all quiet, sitting there as if, like, you're not understanding what I'm saying. Yes? No? You want to know? Immediately the Sahaba, immediately, they said, O Prophet of Allah, tell us, please, inform us, who are these people? Okay, they weren't just sitting there quietly. They were responsive. They interacted with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So they said, O Prophet of Allah, man hum ya Rasulullah, who are these people? Who are these people that because of their rank in the sight of Allah, even the prophets and the martyrs are marveling at them, are wishing to be like them, that we wish we would have had that as well. Wow, that is impressive. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that that category of people, that even the prophets and the martyrs have ghibta over them, who are they? Hum qawmun, they are such a people, tahabbu bi ruhillah, who love each other for the sake of Allah. Ala ghayri arhamin baynahum. Despite there being no relationship. So you're not related by blood. To love for two people, two individuals who love each other for Allah's sake, there's no blood relationship. So you're not related. Wala amwalin yata'atunaha. There's no sale, there's no transaction, there's no dealing. You're not buying or selling. There's no other personal gain. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam then goes to describe what will be such people's condition on the day of judgment. He sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, "Wa fa wallahi inna wujuhahum lanur." On the day of judgment, these people, their faces will be radiant with nur. They'll be recognized. Everybody will know. They'll be very distinct from everybody else on their day of judgment. This category of people, their faces will be shining like noor. Wa innahum ala noor. And they'll be sitting on pulpits of noor. So they will be noor, they'll be sitting on pulpits of noor. La yakhafuna idha khafa an-nas. And when everybody will be petrified on the day of judgment, they'll be chilling. They'll be with peace. They'll have no worry. They won't be fearful on the day of judgment. They'll be fearless when everybody will be fearful. وَلَا يَحْزَنُونَ إِذَا حَزِنَ النَّاسِ. When everybody else will be worried and stressed out on the day of judgment, they will be totally worry and stress free. Nothing to worry about whatsoever. And then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam recited the verse of the Quran, أَلَا إِنَّ أَوْلِيَاءَ اللَّهِ لَا خَوْفٌ عَلَيْهِمْ وَلَا هُمْ يَحْزَنُونَ. That verily the friends of Allah are those who'll have no fear and no worry upon them whatsoever. So, brothers, sisters listening, what we understand here is that this is a great act of ibadah which is neglected. Today we are speaking about a forgotten act of worship, something that most of us don't recognize, as an act of worship. Or if we do, we don't know its value and weight in the sight of Allah. What is it? What is it we're speaking about? Loving somebody else for the sake of Allah. It's a very simple thing to do. Loving somebody else for the sake of Allah. This is a neglected and forgotten act of worship. This is an ibadah, but it's forgotten. It's neglected. Or we don't know the value of it, and we're going to speak about it today. First of all, just look at the honor. Look at the honor in this hadith that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam tells us that if you love somebody just for the sake of Allah, the first thing the hadith mentions, Allah calls you one of His ibad. This is a great thing. To be referred as one of the slaves of Allah, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam from Makkah to Jerusalem and then from there to the seven heavens, He referred to him as my slave. And this was his greatest night on the greatest opportunity. So we learn in this world, one of the greatest stages that you can reach is for Allah to refer to you as one of His special slaves. And that's what's happening here. That I have some special slaves. So number one, if you love somebody for the sake of Allah, Allah refers to you as His special servant. Number two, even the prophets and the martyrs are doing ribda and marveling at this act. On the day of judgment, even the prophets and the martyrs will have ribda over such people. Number three, what an honor that you will be radiant. Your existence will be radiant and distinct. Everyone on the day of judgment will know that you were somebody that loved others for the sake of Allah. Number four, the hadith mentions you'll be sitting on pulpits of noor on the day of judgment. And number five, you'll have nothing to fear. We've heard about the day of judgment, how petrifying and how terrifying it is. Loving another person for the sake of Allah will save you from the terror of the day of judgment. And number six, when everybody will be worried and anxious, what's going to happen to me on the day of judgment? You will have nothing to worry about. Who doesn't want this? Who doesn't want this? How great is the honor? In another hadith we find, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, haqqat mahabbati. In one hadith he says, hadith Qudsi, wajabat mahabbati alal mutahabbina fiyya. My love, Allah says, my love has become due. It's become compulsory. It's become necessary. It's become wajib upon those people who love each other only for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You want to guarantee the love of Allah? Well, learn to love others only for His sake, and you are guaranteed the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We all know how terrifying the day of judgment is going to be. In one hadith we find, on the day of judgment, Allah is going to announce, أَيْلَ الْمُتَحَابُّونَ بِجَلَالِي. Where are those people? Where are those people today who loved one another only for me? I will shade them under my shade on the day يَوْمَ لَا ظِلَّ إِلَّا ظِلُّ. On the day where there'll be no shade besides the shade of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We hear in the famous hadith, seven types of people will be given the shade beneath the arsh of Allah. And one category, رَجُلَان تَحَابَّ فِي اللَّهِ اجْتَمَعَ عَلَيْهِ وَتَفَرَّقَ عَلَيْهِ. The hadith mentions two people, when they met for the sake of Allah. When they parted for the sake of Allah. This is a neglected ibadah, a forgotten act of worship. Learning is something to learn. It just doesn't come like that. We have to learn it. We have to strive for it. We have to talk about it. We have to hear about it. We have to implement it. We have to make a conscious effort and make an intention. Today, I'm going to go out there and I'm going to learn how to love for the sake of Allah. Learn loving others for the sake of Allah. A man came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, hadith of Sahih Bukhari. And he said, O Prophet of Allah, mata sa'a, when is the day of judgment going to occur? And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to him, well, what preparation have you made? You seem very keen for the day of judgment. Are you ready for it? And the man said, O Prophet of Allah, I don't have much preparation, meaning, besides the obligatory actions, salah, fasting in the Ramadan, zakat, etc. I do all of that, but I don't have lots of optional actions. I don't do a lot of voluntary deeds. That's what he means. So I've not got much preparation, meaning voluntary preparation, but there's one thing. I love Allah and I love His Messenger. I love Allah and I love His Messenger. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, "Anta ma'a man ahbabta yawm al-qiyamah," that you will be with who you love on the Day of Judgment. Anas bin Malik says that was the greatest and the most happiest day for us Sahaba. He says, because I love the Messenger of Allah, and I love Abu Bakr, and I love Umar. And although my actions are not like theirs, because of my love for them, I hope to be with them on the Day of Judgment. Just a little reminder for the youth in particular and for all of us. Be very careful who you love. We fall in love with these singers and actors and celebrities and film stars and rock stars. Just think about it, because on the Day of Judgment, you're going to be with who you love. So yes, a bit of entertainment here and there, a bit of an enjoyment, a bit of a refresher, understandable. You like football, you like watching this and that, you like playing a certain game or a sport, and you have these celebrities there. But if you love, you will be with whom you love. You will be with who do you want to be with on the Day of Judgment? It's a very simple thing. Whoever occupies your heart and your mind and overtakes you on the Day of Judgment, Allah will resurrect you with that type of people. And this is why loving for the sake of Allah is very powerful. On the contrary, it's just a reminder that if it's the celebrities of the world that we're going after and they're occupying our minds and our hearts, this should be a limit. There should be a limit and a balance to everything. Yes, you can enjoy, you can follow, you can like their posts and stuff. Okay, you can implement some of their styles and some of their trends, understandable to a degree. But there should be a balance, there should be a cut-off point. And how much room you allow in your heart for another individual. Because whoever occupies that space, on the Day of Judgment, you will be with that individual. So we've just spoken about the virtues, the honor, the blessings of loving for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, my question is, I'm sure you're probably thinking as well, what does it mean to love someone for the sake of Allah? Let's talk practicality. We can talk about theory, and we can talk about concepts, and we can speak about virtues, that we should do this, we should do this, we should do this. How to do it? How? Let's talk about the how. We've spoken about the why, and we've spoken about why it's so important. Let's speak about the how. Let's be practical. Let's be real. Let's face it on, like, let's go for it. Oh, do we want to achieve this, first of all? Do we want this? Do we want to learn how to love others for the sake of Allah? Because the rewards are immense. The rewards are immense. Let's learn how. What does it mean? What does it look like? Loving somebody for the sake of Allah. Number one, someone had a baby. Someone had a baby, right? They're like overjoyed. For you to share in that joy and for you to be happy for them, this is a sign of loving someone for the sake of Allah. Somebody, for example, got a promotion at work. They're happy, but you're celebrating as well. You've got that empathy inside you, and you've got that space inside you to love this person unconditionally. There's no reason. It's just that they're happy, you're happy for them. You're not getting anything out of it. You're not going to gain anything. There's no personal gain or benefit. But you're genuinely happy for another Muslim brother, another Muslim sister. This is part of loving for the sake of Allah. Similarly, someone's had a tragedy. Someone's passed away. You share in their grief. Being there for somebody without expecting anything in return. Just standing by their shoulder. Giving them moral support. Giving them the comfort they need at that time. Not necessarily thinking, oh, when I have bad days, then he'll... No, none of that. Just you doing it because it's the right thing to do at that time, and you're not expecting anything back in return. When you see a friend of yours, a relative of yours, somebody you know, somebody you don't know, when you see them on the right path, you give them encouragement. You see them going down the wrong path, you remind them, you warn them. You don't think, oh, like, he can do his own thing. I don't care. It doesn't matter if he falls, if he slips, if he gets hurt, if he gets burnt down the way. What's he got to do with me? Well, that shows you don't love this person for the sake of Allah. But if you can see the dangers, you've been down that path before, and you know that if this individual carries on like this, they're going to get burnt, they're going to get into trouble, and it's going to be hard for them to get up. And you, without expecting anything else in return, you speak to them, you remind them, share some kind words, share your experience, and look, bro, I've been down this route before. Okay, don't do it. I wouldn't advise it. You're not getting anything out of it yourself. This is one of the ways how we can learn how to love others for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Covering up somebody's faults. covering up their faults, hiding their sins. You know, these kind of things, like, it's unknown of nowadays. People don't know how to do this. We've forgotten how to do these simple human behaviors. Like, someone does something, someone's committing a sin, someone's doing a wrong. It's all about exposing people, telling people about. We actually get a buzz out of it. How twisted have we become? We actually enjoy, like, a conversation. That's what we refer to as a juicy conversation. I've got some info, bro. I've got some really juicy info. And we're like, we can't wait to get it out. Loving for someone for the sake of Allah is covering their faults, hiding their sins. You know, when they're making mistakes, you think of 10 excuses. And when you run out of excuses, you tell yourself, maybe it is an excuse that I've not even thought of. This is loving someone for the sake of Allah. Loving someone for the sake of Allah. And you know, it's unconditional. Yahya ibn Mu'adh used to say, Al-hubbu fillah la yaziduhu al-birr wa la yanqasuhu al-jafa. Loving someone for the sake of Allah is unconditional. It doesn't increase when you do good to me, and it doesn't decrease when you're bad to me. It's not about the other. I don't change my principles because of your behavior towards me. And this is the stage that we need to get to. We think if someone's good to me, I'll be good to them. If someone's bad to me, I'll be bad. No. Why are we giving someone else so much internal power of ours? You are yourself. Be yourself. Be your authentic self. Learn to love other people for the sake of Allah, for Allah, and nothing but Allah. It doesn't matter what you do or what you don't do. Our behavior shouldn't be based on others. It should be based on the principles that we believe and we should be living by. This is authenticity. This is having integrity. This is being a genuine believer. And this is loving someone for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Another way we can show that we love others for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is giving each other their rights. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, a Muslim has 6 rights on another Muslim. When somebody gives you salam, you respond to their salam. When somebody sneezes and says alhamdulillah, you say yarhamukallah. Somebody is sick, you visit them. Somebody passes away, you attend their janazah. Somebody invites you for a meal, you accept their meal. 6 most people don't know. When somebody asks you for advice, you give genuine advice. You give them genuine advice. Somebody asks you, please, like, tell me, what shall I do? I'm stuck. And you genuinely, without any personal gain, you give them genuine advice. This is also one of the ways how we can love somebody for the sake of Allah. In Sahih al-Bukhari, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, لَا يُؤْمِنُ أَحَدُكُمْ حَتَّى يُحِبُّ لِأَخِيهِ مَا يُحِبُّ لِنَفْسِهِ. None of you can become a perfect believer until you love for others what you love for yourself. Your child has become a hafiz of the Quran. You should have that love inside your heart that somebody else's child also becomes a hafiz of the Quran. Your marriage is going perfectly well and prosperous, and you know somebody else is struggling, for you to have that desire for somebody else to also, not to laugh at that situation, not to take advantage and exploit it, rather to wish that others also are prosperous, are also happy, are also successful in their business, in their life, with their children, with their plans, whatever they're going through. How can they also be successful? How can they be prosperous? How can they make the most of what's going on? So this is also a sign of loving for the sake of Allah. Another way how we can learn how to love for the sake of Allah, and a sign, what does it mean that we love somebody for the sake of Allah, is to defend your brother or your sister in their absence. To do it in their presence is very easy, because it's a way of boasting, I stuck up for you. You know, somebody said this and this and you're there. No, when they are not around, your brother, your sister, it doesn't matter who it could be, any Muslim, this is a sign of loving for the sake of Allah. In their absence, to defend somebody in their absence, and it's not easy. Because when 2 people, 3 people are speaking, you're there on the side, you start nodding as well after a bit. There is a bit of that, yeah, I do agree. For you to defend them in that moment and to stick up for them and say, no, look, the brother or sister's not here, it's not right. We shouldn't even be talking about that person behind their back. And that might not be true, and think of excuses. Think of excuses. You're not the judge. You're not the judge. Allah's not going to ask you about that person's behavior. But if you defend somebody, Allah will reward you for it. The hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam: whoever defends their brother or their sister in their absence, Allah will defend you from the hellfire on the day of judgment. You defended somebody and they weren't there, Allah will defend you on the day of judgment. If you want to be defended against the hellfire on the day of judgment, start practicing this from today. Because this is a daily occurrence. Every single day this will happen in your life. Every day that you will end up in a gathering, on a phone call, on a group chat, anywhere you're going to be, and somebody else will be mentioned. For you to defend, go out, make it your purpose. My purpose is to defend people. My purpose is to defend people. Because I love people for the sake of Allah. Their mistakes don't define who they are. I've got mistakes. I've got faults. I've got sins as well. Imagine people spoke about regarding me and defined me for my sins that I've committed. No, that doesn't define who I am. They are an individual. They say, La ilaha illallah. I love that person for the sake of Allah. I wish for that person to improve. And maybe what people are saying, it's not even true. Defending somebody behind their back. And the true essence of loving somebody for the sake of Allah is when you make dua for somebody behind their back. This is the proof that you really love somebody for the sake of Allah. That when you're making dua in your most intimate moments for yourself, for your family, for your health, for your financial struggles, and for your akhirah, at that time you start thinking of other people and start praying for them and making dua for them. We like to talk about things. He should do this and she should do that. And we act as if like we're the greatest well-wishers in the world. And we've got all the ideas how somebody else should live their lives. How many times did you pray for them? Because you can't control somebody, but Allah can. But you might tell them and they might not listen to you. But you can ask Allah to change their heart. You can ask Allah to help them change the situation. But we don't. This is something we don't do. And it shows, unfortunately, our lack of sincerity in our loving people for the sake of Allah. We show that we do. But when it comes to the practical side of things, we're failing. So loving someone for the sake of Allah, pray for them behind their back. And the greatest benefit of that is, number one, you get the reward for that anyway, but an angel will pray the same thing for you as well. So what greater reward do we want than this? A man said to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, I conclude by saying, a man came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and he saw another person walking by. And he says, O Prophet of Allah, you know that person there? I love him for the sake of Allah. I love that person for the sake of Allah. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to that individual, have you told him? Did you inform him about it? He goes, no, I've never told him. He says, go and tell him. You're keeping it to yourself. Go and tell the person. Really? Yeah, he goes, go to him and tell him that I love you for the sake of Allah. So the man goes to him and he tells him, brother, I love you for the sake of Allah. What's the reply? I love you too? Okay, no. The reply is, أَحَبَّكَ اللَّهُ الَّذِي أَحْبَبْتَنِي فِيهِ. Simply, we don't have to say in Arabic because it's not a dua. We don't have to say in Arabic. If somebody comes to you and says you, I love you for the sake of Allah, your reply should be, may Allah love you too. May Allah, because remember, this is, we're taking everything out from here. This love is only for the sake of Allah. So I love you for the sake of Allah. Response to that is, may Allah love you too. Now, we've spoken about many benefits of the honor on the day of judgment, the nur on the day of judgment, that even prophets will marvel at those people who loved each other for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I am initiating now this campaign for the loving for the sake of Allah from this minbar, from this masjid, on this day of Jumuah insha'Allah. And I am announcing from here, brothers, I love you all for the sake of Allah. And the thing is here, is some of you are attending occasionally. There are many of you, I see you regularly, every week in, week out. Passionately, with interest, you sit here from beginning to end. Sometimes, like today, we go over time as well, and you sit there patiently and you listen. We have no dealings, we're not related, we have no transactional dealings, and you're listening to benefit, to learn. And if it wasn't for you guys, who would I be speaking to? So I am really grateful that you make this effort on a weekly basis to come, to sit, to listen so attentively. I pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala increases in this love, May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept this love and help us to learn how to go out into the world and spread loving for the sake of Allah. Who's going to practice this from today, inshallah? How we can start loving each other without any personal gains for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Wa akhiru da'wana and alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. If we can stand up in our places, please. And just keep moving forward until all the spaces are taken. Jazakumullahu khairan. Keep moving forward, keep moving until all the spaces are taken. And keep you can make space for the brothers until all the spaces have been taken.
Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله. أشهد أن محمد رسول الله. أشهد أن محمد رسول الله. حي على الصلاة. حي على الصلاة. حي على الفلاح. حي على الفلاح. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. لا
الحمد لله، الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين، وعلى آله الطيبين الطاهرين وصحابته أجمعين. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن سيدنا ومولانا محمدًا عبده ورسوله، صلى الله تعالى عليه وعلى آله وصحبه، وبارك وسلم تسليمًا كثيرًا كثيرًا. أعوذ بالله السميع العليم من الشيطان الرجيم. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته، ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. الحمد لله، الحمد لله، نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه، ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فلا مضل له، ومن يضلله فلا هادي له. ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، ونشهد أن سيدنا ومولانا محمدًا عبده ورسوله، صلى الله تعالى عليه وعلى آله وصحبه، وبارك وسلم تسليمًا كثيرًا كثيرًا. الكرام. أما بعد فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا ونبينا وشفيعنا وحبيبنا وسندنا ومولانا محمد وبارك وسلم. اللهم اغفر للمؤمنين والمؤمنات والمسلمين والمسلمات وألف بين قلوبهم وأصلح ذات بينهم وانصرهم على عدوك وعدوهم. اللهم انصرنا ولا تنصر علينا ولا تسلط علينا بذنوبنا من لا يخافك فينا ولا يرحمنا. اللهم احفظ الحرمين الشريفين والمسجد الأقصى المبارك. اللهم حرر المسجد الأقصى من كيد الغاصبين. اللهم أعد المسجد الأقصى إلى رحاب المسلمين واستعملنا في تحريره يا رب العالمين. إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون. فاذكروني أذكركم واشكروا لي ولا تكفرون. Straighten the row, stand shoulder to shoulder, ensure there's no gaps in between. If we see any gaps, as quickly as possible, please fill in the gaps. Jazakumullahu khairan. الله أكبر. الحمد لله رب العالمين، الرحمن الرحيم، مالك يوم الدين، إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين، اهدنا الصراط المستقيم، صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. سبح اسم ربك الأعلى الذي خلق فسوى والذي قدر فهدى والذي أخرج المرعى فجعله غثاء أحوى. سنقرئك فلا تنسى إلا ما شاء الله، إنه يعلم الجهر وما يخفى. ونيسرك لليسرى فذكر إن نفعت الذكرى. سيذكر من يخشى ويتجنبها الأشقى الذي يصلى النار الكبرى ثم لا يموت فيها ولا يحيا. قد أفلح من تزكى وذكر اسم ربه فصلى. بل تؤثرون الحياة الدنيا والآخرة خير وأبقى. إن هذا لفي الصحف الأولى صحف إبراهيم وموسى. الله سمع الله لمن حمده. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الحمد لله رب العالمين، الرحمن الرحيم، مالك يوم الدين، إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. هل أتاك حديث الغاشية وجوه يومئذ خاشعة عاملة ناصبة تصلى نارا حامية تسقى من عين آنية ليس لهم طعام إلا من ضريع لا يسمن ولا يغني من جوع وجوه يومئذ ناعمة لسعيها راضية في جنة عالية لا تسمع فيها لاغية فيها عين جارية فيها سرر مرفوعة وأكواب موضوعة ونمارق مصفوفة وزرابي مبثوثة أفلا ينظرون إلى الإبل كيف خلقت وإلى السماء كيف رفعت وإلى الجبال كيف نصبت وإلى الأرض كيف سطحت فذكر إنما أنت مذكر لست عليهم بمسيطر إلا من تولى وكفر فيعذبه الله العذاب الأكبر إن إلينا إيابهم ثم إن علينا حسابهم. الله سمع الله لمن حمده. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. Brothers, just before you leave, a very important announcement. Tomorrow, inshallah, in this masjid after Isha, Isha will be at 6:30. Ummah Welfare Trust are holding a very special program in which Sheikh Ahmad Ali, the world-renowned famous orator, will be speaking, inshallah, on the virtues and the legacy of Sayyidina Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu, alongside Morana Muhammad Ahmad, who is the one of the founding trustees of Ummah Welfare Trust. So a great opportunity for us to attend. Brothers, sisters, children, everybody is requested to please attend tomorrow, 6:30, and there'll be food served for everybody as well after the program. And on Sunday morning, inshallah, from Fajr onwards, we'll be having a great Fajr campaign. Again, Fajr is at 6:45. Everybody is welcome to attend. Brothers, sisters, children, please do make an effort, and breakfast will be served, inshallah, after Ishraq. So please do make an effort to attend on Sunday as well. Jazakumullah khaira. Make dua of shifa for sister Latifa Abdul Mannan Khalfe, who's ill in hospital, and similarly sister Hamida Sange from Tanzania, who's also in hospital. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant them and all those who are going through difficulties shifa and afiyah. Allahumma anta as-salam wa minka as-salam tabarak. باركت يا ذا الجلال والإكرام اللهم لا مانع لما أعطيت ولا معطي لما منعت ولا ينفع ذا الجد منك الجد اللهم أعني على ذكرك وشكرك وحسن عبادتك اللهم اغفر لحينا وميتنا وشاهدنا وغائبنا وصغيرنا وكبيرنا وذكرنا وأنثانا اللهم من أحييته منا فأحيه على الإسلام ومن توفيته منا فتوفه على الإيمان اللهم يا شافي الأمراض اشف مرضانا واشف مرض المسلمين اللهم إنا نسألك العفو والعافية والمعافاة الدائمة في الدين والدنيا والآخرة اللهم إنا نسألك الصحة والعفة والأمانة وحسن الخلق والرضاء بالقدر اللهم آت نفوسنا تقواها وزكها أنت خير من زكاها أنت وليها ومولاها اللهم إنا نسألك من خير ما سألك منه نبيك محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم ونعوذ بك من شر ما استعاذ منه نبيك محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم أنت المستعان وعليك البلاغ ولا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون وسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين.
Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. Ashhadu an la
Allahu Akbar, Allah.